We are just now starting to uncover the science behind a new piece of the obesity epidemic that connects the genetics of obesity with the environment and lifestyle choices. As it turns out, this connection begins during the very early stages of life, during a process known as fetal programming. We've recognized for many decades that health outcomes of newborns are directly impacted by lifestyle choices of their mothers during pregnancy. The detrimental effects of smoking, alcohol, and drug use during pregnancy on newborn children is well known. We are just now starting to realize that more subtle events during pregnancy also impact health outcomes for children. Research now supports a multitude of events, including maternal nutrition, that determines health outcomes for children, especially a predisposition to obesity. Many of these events are not manifested until adulthood in those offspring. Furthermore, some of the predisposing events are made even worse by certain postnatal environments, including excess nutrition. Fetal programming describes the process through which environmental factors, including nutrition, act in early life to program the risks for a myriad of adult diseases, including diabetes, obesity, and cancer. Although fetal programming has been associated with negative health outcomes in offspring, it's also important to realize that programming for resistance to disease is just as likely. David Barker showed that lower birth weight babies were at greater risk for coronary heart disease later in life. His data showed that the risk of heart disease and mortality index falls as birth weight increased. So this translates to the observation that individuals with low birth weights are at greater risk for coronary heart disease and shortened lifespan. However, another important feature of this data is that the highest birth weights are also associated with a reduced longevity and point to an optimal birth weight across a spectrum of birth weight. The effect of birth weight has also been linked to the ability of adult offspring to metabolize glucose. The test for this link is determined by a simple diagnostic procedure known as a glucose tolerance test. This test evaluates the ability of an individual to metabolize a glucose drink by tracking changes in blood glucose concentrations. Normally, glucose in blood is elevated either after a meal or, in this case, in response to a sugary drink. The increase in glucose concentration is sensed by the beta cells of the pancreas, which then release insulin to act on fat and muscle cells to increase their ability to extract glucose from blood and therefore promote its storage for later use. The normal blood profile for glucose tolerance test is shown here. Blood glucose rises in response to the glucose drink. The rise in blood sugar triggers a release of insulin. This causes the concentration of glucose to drop as tissues extract glucose from blood. In normal individuals, the concentration of glucose in blood returns to pre-test levels within about 2 hours. When either insulin release or insulin action is impaired, a greater rise in blood glucose is observed, and the concentration of glucose remains elevated after 2 hours, a condition known as glucose intolerance. This simple test is often used as a screening tool for type 2 diabetes and to test for insulin and glucose intolerance during pregnancy, a condition known as gestational diabetes. In defining fetal programming, David Barker and his colleagues observed that low birth weight was also linked to an inability in individuals to respond normally to a blood glucose challenge test. These individuals had elevated 2-hour blood glucose concentrations. Glucose intolerance in this case is also an indicator of insulin resistance, and both conditions are often observed with obesity. It's become apparent that the level of nutrition during pregnancy not only impacts the health of the mom and birth weight of the offspring, but also the risk of obesity and related diseases. This picture is a clear example of this effect. Dietary inadequacy during pregnancy can result in low birth weight in many species, including laboratory rats. When the low birth weight pup and the normal pup are given access to the same energy-rich diet after birth, there is a period of catch-up growth in the low birth weight individual that results in a predisposition to obesity in later life. In addition to undernutrition during pregnancy, there are several other conditions during fetal development that lead to obesity and diabetes in offspring. These include low protein diets during pregnancy, insufficient uterine arterial blood flow, and maternal stress. The impact of these conditions highlights the fact that fetal programming not only impacts offspring health during food scarcity, but also in settings where food may be plentiful. Consequently, fetal programming of offspring is just as likely to occur in all areas of the world. One of the factors that leads to full manifestation of the effects of fetal programming is the mismatch of maternal diet with postnatal diet. For example, if nutrition is restricted during the fetal development period, but calories are plentiful during the postnatal period, then the incidence of obesity in offspring is magnified. This mismatch of fetal and postnatal diet has led to discoveries linking the fetal environment with signals that direct the genetic code of the offspring and predisposition towards obesity. This process is known as epigenetics, which is defined as a change in DNA function that does not involve alterations in the DNA sequence. So the question becomes, how is the information in the maternal environment transmitted to the developing fetus? We know that all cells in the body have the same DNA. However, this DNA results in cells with very different functions, as determined by the sets of genes that are expressed in cells. Genes can be activated to synthesize RNA that is a template for specific protein synthesis. The synthesis of RNA is controlled by the activity of a region of a gene in DNA called a promoter. The ability of the promoter to activate RNA synthesis is controlled by proteins that bind to the DNA promoter region and switch on the transcription machinery of the cell. Correct binding of proteins results in multiple copies of RNA being made from the DNA template. One of the most common epigenetic marks on DNA is methylation of cytosine bases. This does not change the base code of the DNA, but simply adds a chemical group to cytosine. A feature of DNA that lends itself to epigenetic markings occurs when several guanine and cytosine bases are clustered together in a DNA strand in something known as a CpG island. These clusters are targets on DNA that lead to a condition of methyl residues on the cytosine bases. Methylation of cytosine residues in CpG islands impairs binding of transcription factor proteins to DNA, and in essence, switches the gene off. We're now learning that the in utero environment influences the epigenetic switches that are set on DNA and determines the expression of a spectrum of genes, several of which control metabolism in offspring and respond to postnatal nutrition. Not only is it apparent that half of the genes in our cells come from each of our parents, but it's now becoming clear that some of the epigenetic marks from each parent are also passed forward for at least two generations. This means that our response to diet and risks for obesity throughout our lifetime is affected in part by the diet and the lifestyle choices of our parents and our grandparents. This new knowledge from epigenetics has helped us to understand the biological basis through which offspring are programmed in utero for the environment that they will experience at birth and beyond. We're now aware that fetal programming alters appetite regulation in offspring, changes adiposity and fat cell metabolism, alters the ability to control metabolic capacity, and influences the sensitivity to hormones as well as changing initiative for physical activity. Although poor maternal nutrition has been linked to negative consequences of fetal programming, it is equally critical to remember that overnutrition can have a similar negative consequence. Uncovering the biology behind fetal programming and the link to epigenetics will hopefully enable us to make better diet and lifestyle recommendations for optimal health of future generations. It's also important to realize that the full manifestation of the impact of fetal programming is determined by nutritional and other lifestyle factors, and that any negative impacts of fetal programming can be overcome as a consequence of the plasticity of development. A considerable proportion of this occurs postnatally.